Good morning, my fellow archaeologists. We are here at Destination Dig, stepping into what is our final day online. I hope you guys got plenty of rest last night and that you woke up refreshed and had a hearty breakfast to start your day. Now today we have a jam-packed day and an awesome lesson from our last guest teacher, Pastor John, about how Jesus was betrayed and arrested, but ultimately had the victory over sin and death, a victory that he shares with you and me. Now, many of you guys, I know you know these parts of the Bible already, but there's always something deeper that we can unearth when we dig into God's Word. And we also have another great craft and snack time with our student helpers. Haven't they been awesome this week? We're so grateful for them. Now, if you're ready, let's start with a prayer and ask God for His help to worship and seek Him with all of our hearts. Would you bow your heads with me? Lord, as we step into our last day online, I pray that You would bless this time. Lord, we thank You that even though we are apart, that we are together in spirit in the name of Jesus. We worship You, God. We need Your strength to keep on searching after You. And we thank You that when we seek truth, we find not just a thing or things or people, but we find Jesus. We find Jesus Himself. And we pray that He would be at the center of this time, really in all of our lives, but Lord, that this time that we have together would be really special, and that You would show us a deeper truth about the stories that we've heard many times before, that we would learn something new, that it would touch our hearts in a new and special way. And so Lord, we thank You for this awesome opportunity to worship You together. We pray that we will learn more and more about who You are. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right guys, let's dig in.
What an exciting week we've had so far. We're digging for the truth about Jesus. Let's review a few things that we are learning this week. Our theme verse, if you will remember, is Jeremiah 29:13, which says, "You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart." You know, God is not difficult to find. He isn't hiding from us. God tells us that if we seek Him with all of our heart, that we can find Him. And our motto this week is this: seek truth, find Jesus. Seek truth, find Jesus. You know, we have learned that Jesus is the Savior that God promised. We have also learned that Jesus has the power that God promised. Today, we're going to learn that Jesus knew what would happen, but still followed God's plan to be our Savior. Following God's plan was not easy. Jesus was betrayed, He was rejected, and ultimately, He was killed. In the final moments of Jesus' life, He has a dinner with His disciples. This is known as the Last Supper. During the meal, Jesus shares with them that one of the disciples, will betray Him. To betray someone is when you break a trust or break their trust. If your friend tells you a secret and you promise not to tell anyone, but then you go and tell someone, you have broken that person's trust and you have betrayed your friend. We have all been betrayed at one point in our life. You know, when that happens, it hurts a lot. It's really hard to get that trust back. Would you trust your friend again? Most likely not. A man named Judas betrayed Jesus. Judas was one of Jesus' 12 disciples. This means that Judas was close to Jesus. He had spent a lot of time with Jesus as well as the other disciples. It was someone that Jesus trusted. But we find out here in the Last Supper, in the conversation, Jesus says, hey, one of you is going to betray me. And Judas actually leaves the dinner. And after the dinner, Jesus goes with the disciples to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. Judas had gone to meet up with the religious leaders so that he could take them where Jesus would be so that they could arrest him. As Jesus is praying in the garden, Judas comes with the religious leaders as well as some soldiers. They come to arrest Jesus. But Peter, I love Peter, right? He is one of those guys that will always come to your defense. Peter, he pulls out a sword. He strikes the ear of one of the servants of the high priest. He strikes the ear and the ear falls off. The person is bleeding. But look what Jesus says in verse 11. Put away your sword. Put your sword away. Am I not to drink the cup the Father has given me? Am I not to drink the cup the Father has given me? Am I not to drink the cup means, should I not accept what the God the Father has given me? Peter is really concerned about Jesus. He's like, you will not arrest him over my dead body. So he takes out the sword to defend Jesus. But Jesus is willing to be arrested. Jesus tells him, put the sword away. Am I not to drink this cup? Am I not to do what the Father has called me to do? Put your sword away. He is willing, Jesus is willing to be arrested, go to the cross. He understood that this was his purpose. Jesus is God's son. He knows everything. This means that Jesus knew that Judas would betray him, but he still chose him as one of his disciples. Jesus knew that he would be arrested. He knew that he would face the cross, but still, he came. It's amazing that Jesus knew what would happen, but still followed God's plan. Jesus is arrested. He was betrayed by Judas, one of his disciples. And he is ready to go to the cross. So we see that Jesus is betrayed. But not only is he betrayed, he is also rejected. Why did Jesus come? To be our Savior. But he is rejected by the religious leaders. Jesus is arrested. He is put on trial. Now, when you are accused of something, they have to bring evidence. So with Jesus, they tried to find evidence and they did not have a very strong case. But they had to charge him with something. So they accused Jesus of blasphemy. Blasphemy is when a person says or does something that is disrespectful to God. So in the eyes of the religious leaders, when Jesus claimed that he was God's son, he was insulting God. He committed blasphemy. But the funny thing is, it was the truth. Jesus is God's son. He was sent to be our Savior. Jesus came to die for our sins, but he was rejected. You know, Jesus is found guilty. He is sentenced to die. Jesus was crucified on the cross, died and buried. But the amazing thing is that Jesus did not remain in the tomb. On the third day, he rose from the grave. In John chapter 20, verse 1, we see that Mary finds an empty tomb. It says, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark. She saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. She was shocked to find the large stone that guarded the entrance of the tomb had been rolled away. A million things ran through her mind. Her heart began to race. What had happened? Who had been here? And this feeling sunk in her heart like somebody messed with the body of Jesus. She goes and tells Peter and John. Peter and John run to the tomb. They go inside, but there is no body. What happened to Jesus? You know, Mary is sad. She's outside crying. She's sad because she feels or she believes that somebody had taken the body of Jesus. The fact that Jesus would rise again, she could not even think about that. As she is crying, a man appears to her and asks, "Why are you crying?" And she tells him, "Someone has taken the body of my Lord Jesus." And as she is talking to this person, the person calls her name, Mary. And immediately, Mary knew that it was Jesus. She recognized the voice. She looked up, she saw Jesus. Jesus was alive. She couldn't wait to tell the disciples that Jesus was alive, that Jesus, that she saw Jesus. You know, Jesus knew what would happen, but still followed God's plan to be our Savior. Jesus knew about the betrayal. He knew about the rejection. He knew about the pain and suffering on the cross. He knew it all, but he still followed God's plan. Jesus followed God's plan because he loves you so much. You know, our Christ connection today is this. God sent Jesus to seek and save sinners. When we trust in Jesus as Savior, when we trust in Jesus as Savior and Lord, he forgives our sins and he gives us eternal life. God loves you so much that he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for you. Have you put your trust in Jesus? You know, you can do that right now. All you have to do is ask Jesus to help you to put your trust in him and invite him into your heart. Let's pray. Father God, we pray. We thank you for your son. We thank you, Lord God, that you sent your son Jesus, that even though he knew he would be rejected, betrayed, that he would die a painful death on the cross, he came so that he can be our Savior. We thank you for your great sacrifice. We thank you for your great love. For those of us who put our trust in Jesus, we can have the eternal life that is promised. So this morning we pray. As the children in our church have been discovering the truth, digging for the truth about who Jesus is, we thank you, Lord God, that today we discover that Jesus is our Savior. That all we have to do is put our trust in you. Would you help each person listening to this message to put their trust in you, to ask you to come into their heart? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Nash Bash crew, Biblical History Center Day 3.
Sadie and I had gotten a lot done with our project. No other book has had more impact in the world than the Bible. And at the center of the Bible is Jesus. The whole book points to him. For Sadie and me, the more we learned, the more excited we got. But for Zach, well, he just seemed to be more and more distant. We tried to cheer him up, but nothing seemed to work.
Okay, so now it is time for Best Prank Ever! Okay, Sadie, you go first. What is the greatest prank you have ever pulled?
Okay, well, when I was at camp, my friends and I wore our clothes backwards all day. People were doing double takes at us. It was hilarious.
All right, so the crazy side of Sadie is coming out.
Lame.
Okay, Zach, I know you have to have one.
So, there's a sidewalk that goes by my house. It's like the main walkway to get to the park in my neighborhood. Me and my brother took some branches and made up some bush costumes, and we crouched down by the sidewalk, and we jump up and scare everybody. We got my mom one time, and she chased my brother all the way to the park.
Okay, that's so much better than mine.
Your brother sounds as crazy as you. Do you guys still prank?
Me and my mom don't hear from him anymore. Things got tough at home, and he just left.
That's tough, dude.
Whatever. I'm used to people leaving me.
Sorry I'm late, guys. I was just engaged in an epic game of Ultimate Frisbee. What are we doing?
We were taking a break, talking about pranks.
Okay. Prank. My turn. All right, so this one time, I was giving a group a tour here at the Roman Rock Quarry exhibit. And so I came over here to show them the lift. And Dr. Drummond, he walked up and he was like, "Hey, Joel, why don't you show them how the lift works?" And I was like, "You got it, Doc. You're the boss." And so I got in, and then Dr. Drummond lifted me way up high in the air. And then he took the tour group to the next exhibit, and then the next one. And I was stuck in here for hours. It's pretty funny.
So you're telling me that thing will lift you in the air?
Yeah. Come on. I'll show you how it works. I do it all the time. Yep, I'll hold that for you. Hey, did you guys know that archaeologists have uncovered rock quarries all around the city of Jerusalem? That's where they cut the stone in order to build the ancient buildings and roadways and walkways around Jerusalem. Archaeologists have also uncovered an ancient stone structure called Caiaphas Steps. It's this pathway that runs through a part of Jerusalem. Jesus even walked on these steps. I actually have a video of me and Barney on Caiaphas Steps in Jerusalem. It's back in my office if you guys want to see it.
Sounds great, Professor.
Can't wait to see it. Meet you there.
Okay. Meet you there. But first, hey, first, guys, why do I keep letting this happen to me?
Today, I'm taking you to a very special archaeological site. Today, we're talking about something that any honest student of history cannot deny. Jesus of Nazareth suffered in Jerusalem. This story is always hard to tell. In fact, it makes me want to do something nice. Hey, Barney, do you remember how Jesus washed his disciples' feet? Well, to say thanks for being a great friend, I'm gonna wash your feet, man.
No thanks.
Come on, buddy.
No thanks.
Give me your foot. I want to wash your feet, bro. Stop struggling. All right, Barney, go stand over there by the steps.
I don't want to.
I'm sorry about your shoe. All right, I didn't mean to drop it in that fountain after I forcefully took it off your foot. Just please, go stand by the steps, okay? Be my friend.
Fine.
These are the original steps of Caiaphas. This was the main path between many of the places Jesus would have traveled. These steps are on the way to Caiaphas' palace, which we'll talk about in a sec. Jesus would have walked up and down these steps often. Where would this path take him? Well, let's see. The Mount of Olives. It's likely Jesus often traveled down the steps through the valley to this place. This is the way Jesus traveled to see his friends, Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. The Bible says Jesus visited the Mount of Olives 3 times in the last week of his earthly life. It also tells us that from here, Jesus rode a donkey down into Jerusalem, where a crowd of people began to praise God for all of the miracles they had seen. The Bible also tells us that Jesus preached to great crowds here. All right, look right over there. Somewhere over there was the upper room where Jesus washed his disciples' feet and had the Last Supper. These steps would have held happy memories for Jesus, but they also were a place of his great sufferings. Let's go back for a second to the Mount of Olives. Come on. This is the Garden of Gethsemane. The Bible tells us that this is the place where Jesus was betrayed by his supposed friend and follower Judas. After being arrested, they led Jesus down the hill toward the Caiaphas steps. So Jesus would have walked down from the Mount of Olives, across the Kidron Valley, and all the way up these steps to the courtyard of Caiaphas at the top. Matthew chapter 26 tells us that all of Jesus' disciples deserted him and ran away. Right here, in the courtyard of Caiaphas, Peter, Jesus' supposed fearless follower and friend, denied 3 times that he even knew who Jesus was at all. Wow, talk about feeling abandoned. Archaeologists believe that it was in this building that Jesus was lied about and mocked. He was punched and slapped and people spit in his face. He may have been held in a dungeon like this one overnight until the next morning when they took him before Pilate. Have you ever been made fun of? I'm sure you tried to get the person to stop, right? Jesus didn't ask anyone to stop hitting him, spitting on him, or mocking him. Here, Jesus suffered greatly before they led him back down those steps and off to the governor, Pontius Pilate.
The work of archaeologists to uncover sites like these, along with the eyewitness accounts, tell us that the suffering of Jesus was real suffering in real places like this. Jesus knew what was going to happen to him, and still, he fully followed God's plan.
Are you kidding me? I mean, his friends, his own people, they just leave? They completely run away. Why would Jesus stick around for people like that? One minute they say love him, one minute they say to kill him? How am I supposed to believe that someone would die for a bunch of people who would run away at the first sign of trouble? I wouldn't stick around, that's for sure. Leave me alone.
The day before was pretty rough for Zach. The professor's talk about Jesus being abandoned and betrayed really hit him hard. But he seemed better that morning. Different than I had seen him before.
First, the Twinkie. Then goes the hot dog. And for the culinary curveball, spray cheese. I present to you the Nash Bash dog. Bon appetit.
Dude, that is awesome.
So, what do you think? You up for finishing this project? I don't know what you said, but I think it's good news.
Come on, baby. I cannot get this thing open. It's almost like somebody glued it shut or something. Good one, Dr. Drummond. The professors are just pranking me. Although, I am kind of bummed. Because I made one of Barney's special olive loaf sandwiches, and they are legendary. Awesome. But anyway, so what's going on?
I've been researching sites that people claim are the real locations that Jesus carried the cross, was crucified, and buried, but none of the archaeologists can agree. Do you know? I just want to get it right for our project.
Yes, 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 yes. I thought you might ask that question, which is why I sent you another one of my videos. Please check your electronic mail.
Oh, here it is.
The most important thing when making my famous olive loaf sandwich is to finely crush exactly 25 olives. I found that a heavy hammer works best.
Wrong video. So sorry. Barney is very passionate about olives. Anyway, click the next link. Today, we're talking about the place where Jesus suffered and died on the cross. But first, we have to talk about how Jesus got from the governor's headquarters, also called the Praetorium, to the place he would be crucified. Where's the olive loaf you packed?
I didn't.
What? But I'm hungrier than like a camel, combined with a donkey with the legs of a mountain lion.
What?
It just means I'm really hungry, okay?
Why didn't you just say, I'm really hungry?
This is the supposed Via Dolorosa. That is Latin for the way of suffering. Let's take a stroll. Tradition states that this is the route Jesus would have taken on his way to the site where he would be crucified. The problem is that this city has been rebuilt again and again over time. These stones we're standing on probably date back to the Middle Ages, over 1,000 years after the time of Jesus. This made it difficult to determine the location of Jesus' path to Calvary until the coolest thing was discovered by archaeologists. Underground passage. Dun, dun, dun!
These stones date back to the time of Jesus. These may have been the actual stones that his feet walked upon. These paths lead to a few different destinations. Jesus could have been crucified here on the north side of the city of Jerusalem, or he could have been crucified here on the northwest side of the city. What we do know is that Roman crucifixions could have occurred at different locations in the city. We know for sure that no one survived Roman crucifixion. Jesus certainly died, and he would have ended up in a place like this. The eyewitness accounts tell us that Jesus was buried in a wealthy person's tomb where a stone, like that one, was rolled in front to seal it shut. There are multiple tombs discovered by archaeologists, just like the one described in the eyewitness accounts. Archaeology may not be able to determine which is the actual site, but it gives us information about how Jesus would have been buried. Eyewitnesses report that Jesus was crucified by Rome. The archaeological evidence and historical writings to support that fact they're overwhelming. Okay, so then the eyewitnesses tell us that Jesus' body was buried in a stone tomb that was sealed with a stone. Again, the archaeological evidence supports this. All right, now listen. Just as Jesus predicted in Matthew chapter 12, after he was crucified, after he was buried, on the third day, he rose from the dead. It's incredible. And the eyewitnesses tell us in the Bible that Jesus appeared to hundreds of other eyewitnesses after he rose from the dead around Israel. Amazing. All right, let me ask you something. Where would be the easiest place to disprove the resurrection? Like, where would be the easiest place to prove that Jesus was still dead? Right here in Jerusalem. But listen to me. They could not prove that Jesus was still dead. You want to know why? Because in his tomb, there was no body. His tomb was empty. Okay, take a look at this picture of a Roman cross. Oftentimes when we see depictions of Jesus on the cross, he's up on a high hill, on a tall cross, way far away from everyone else. But look how close he might have been to those around him. While he was suffering, he could look into the eyes of those who were passing by him. You see, the Bible says that Jesus died on the cross to forgive our sins. But that's not the end of the story. Come with me. I want to show you something. Jesus died on the cross, and they took his body and laid it in a stone tomb that may have looked something like this. But 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead to give us eternal life. When we repent and we put our trust in Jesus as our Savior and our Lord, our sins are forgiven and we become a part of the Lord's forever family. I mean, for 2,000 years, people have been trusting in Jesus and their lives have been getting transformed. And when I look at the archaeological evidence and the eyewitness accounts and all the transformed lives, it convinced me. And ever since the day I put my trust in Jesus, well, I've never been the same. So, what, or really, who are you going to put your trust in?
Hello, welcome to BBS Craft Bay 3. We're gonna make a bracelet today, but there are these beads that has letter on them hidden in the sand. You see, the name of the BVS this year is Destination Dig. And we're talking about unearthing the Jesus' truth, like an archaeologist. So we're gonna see what kind of letters are on the beads today. So let's open this. When you open the lid, you can start digging with this stick over here. And there are some beads coming out from my sand. And when you find these, there might be sand like in the hole. So you might want to take it out with something sharp in order to make a bracelet. So I found all the letters. So when you finish digging, you can put the sand on the side and you can reuse them and play with them later. So there are beads in here, very colorful. When you can open this and you can put them on the lid, which is very easy. And when you open this instruction paper, there will be this clear thread. And you can put, when you look at the instruction, you get to know what these letters match up to. So you can just start putting these beads, and there will be this church shaped thing too, and you can put it on the middle or the beads or like anywhere. It's really up to you. So after I found all the beads, I finished the bracelet. Doesn't it look so pretty? After that, you want to cut it over here so it won't really bother you while you wear it, and make sure the knot is tight. And that is it for the Beavis Craft Day 3.
Please, please wash us. We are very dirty. Please, please wash us. We are very dirty. Filthy and grubby. Everything gets muddy.
I turn up the water. Put soap on my hands. It's slippery and slick.
Foam.
It splishes and splashes.
Clean.
Shake, rub, crumple. I turn up the water, put soap on my hands. It's slippery and slick.
Foam!
It splishes and splashes.
Clean!
Shake, rub, crumple, dry!
Yay!
Hi, welcome back to Day 3 Snacks. So today we'll be making Jesus' tomb. And you'll need a knife and a plate, and these two will be in your bag for Day 3. So first of all, let's take this out. And we're gonna cut it into half. Okay, after you cut it, you put the other one to half, and you're gonna make it stand like this. And then after that, you're gonna open the chip bag. And you can see there's gonna be chips, and you're gonna put it right in front of it like this too. This cookie represents the rock. And when Jesus was dead, it was closed up like this, but then Jesus came back alive, so it opened up like this, and that is how you make Jesus' tomb. Enjoy!
Now, Day 3 quiz coming up. First question, who asked to take care of Jesus' body?
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Joseph of Arimathea.
Second question, who was Mary Magdalene really talking to in the garden? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The answer is Jesus. Now, the true or false question. Jesus fulfilled God's plan to be our Savior. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The answer is true. And this was the last quiz session from this VBS.
Guys, we have made it through the final third day of our online portion of Destination Dig. Congratulations, guys. You have been so wonderful and have had such a great attitude. We love the photos. You know, we're so glad that you decided to join us for Destination Dig and hope that you learn truths about Jesus that will deepen your love and trust in Jesus and also help you to share about Jesus with your friends and people that you meet. You know, two amazing truths that we learned today from Pastor John was that Jesus knew what would happen to him, and yet he still followed God's plan by dying on the cross and rising again from the dead. Jesus fulfilled God's plan to be our Savior. Now, we learned together this week that when we seek truth, we always find Jesus, and that when we seek after God with all of our hearts, we will find him. And lastly, our Christ connection these past 3 days has been that God sent Jesus to seek and save sinners. And when we trust in Jesus as Savior and Lord, he forgives our sins and gives us eternal life. Now, we want to thank all of our teachers, pastors, and helpers for all their time and hard work to make Destination Dig possible this year. And of course, we want to thank you for being part of it and making it all worthwhile for us. We do it for you guys 100%, and we know that God is so happy when you make time to seek after him. And most of all, we want to thank God for sending Jesus to save us, and that through Jesus we have forgiveness of our sins and the gift of eternal life. And so thank you guys once again for all your dedication this week. Now, remember that coming up tomorrow is our grand finale of Destination Dig at Church, and we're going to wrap up things by learning that the Bible is true and how it helps us to tell others about Jesus. And so don't miss out, guys, on this opportunity to safely meet together and have a blast digging deep into God's Word one more time. And so we have a time of teaching, body worship, crafts, food, and games all planned for you guys. So get your masks, your t-shirts, and your bags ready for an awesome time tomorrow. Now, let's end today by praying and giving praise and glory to God. Would you bow your heads with me? Lord, we did it. We thank you so much, God, for the last 3 days where we have been digging deep, Father, to find out truths about who you are and who Jesus is and all the incredible things that he did, how he shows your power, how he followed your plan, how he obeyed God no matter what happened, no matter how scary the things that were coming up for him were. Father, he loved us by dying on the cross, and Lord, he glorified you by rising from the dead. Lord, there are so many things that we learned. We pray that you would plant them into our hearts, that we would know them with our minds, but believe it with our hearts, and that you would use the things that we learned to tell others about Jesus and who he is, what he did for us. So Lord, we are just so thankful for all the things that we were able to do together. We pray for tomorrow, that as we meet, that you would keep us safe, that you would help us to have an amazing time learning more about who you are, worshiping you, fellowshipping with one another through games and activities, and even lunchtime. So Lord, we just give you the glory for all that you gave us this week during Destination Dig. We pray, God, that you would be with each student and each family, and that you would help them to grow in their understanding and knowledge of who you are. We thank you, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, great job, guys. We will see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
The savior of the world, and now we can call him friend. God sent his son, he's the savior of the world, and now we can call him friend. Son, he's the savior of the world, and now we can call him friend. God sent his son, he's the savior of the world, and now we can call him friend.
Jesus Savior, Jesus Savior.
You will see me and find me when you see me with all your heart.
You will see me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13. Amen.
You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13. Amen.
You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13. Amen.
You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Jeremiah 29, 13.